for something out there. Out of reach, couldn't stop you, couldn't hold you back. You were so real, so real. When the
back in spring we set ourselves a challenge. We decided we were going to try and catch a 40-pound carp out of our local busy park lake. Eventually we succeeded, we caught the fish we were after, and we called it the Park Lake Campaign. Ever since then though, we've been thinking, you know, what can we set our minds on next? What can be our next adventure? We've decided to concentrate our efforts on our local almost 300-acre reservoir. Welcome to the Reservoir Diaries.
Our previous target waters throughout our last 4 years of carp fishing have ranged between 1 and 10 acres, but here we were starting at one of the largest pieces of water in the southeast. We were certain this was going to be our biggest challenge yet. We're standing on a pretty big hill looking over the reservoir. You've got the nature reserve over this side and you've got the fishing side over that side.
Now, the fishing side is, what, 280 acres?
Yeah, I think so.
And the nature reserve, well, that's pretty big as well. What that means is the location is going to be the absolute number one, like, key thing whilst we're fishing here. Carp stocks, well, we don't really know, do we? The fact is, we know there are carp in here. We've seen photos in the lodge of a handful of carp. We haven't seen photos of very many. We're not really picking out target fish or anything just because we don't really know what's in here. There could be some really big secrets, but on the contrary, there could also be nothing.
But the aim of today is to explore. We're going to be getting the boat out later, driving it up and down the reservoir, trying to find spots that we can fish, and hopefully we will find somewhere to fish on our first session.
And you never know, we might even spot a carp, but it's highly unlikely.
Yeah.
Anyway, let's go, let's get the boat out and see what we can find.
Yeah.
As we said, we were going to get the boat out. We didn't quite expect the rain to come down like it is now. As you can see behind me here, you've got the dam. And basically what happened is, there was an old stream called the Medway running down this valley. They built this whole massive dam across, basically flooding the whole valley. Valley filled up with water, so you've got the reservoir that you see before us. And along the middle of the reservoir, where the old stream runs down, that's where you get the deepest water. So I think what we'll do is we'll get the engine going again, see if we can explore the rest of the reservoir. I'm soaked.
I'm soaked as well.
Yeah, lovely.
Just pulled up the boat onto land. It's still raining like crazy. Not the best day for exploring. We're quite near the nature reserve. You can see on top of the hill, the nature reserve. And maybe it's one of the spots we'll concentrate on for our next few sessions, because it is still very mild for the time of year. Although it's raining, it's warm rain, and we're getting a lot of warm winds. So I think that's where we'll concentrate our fishing for the first few sessions. But I suppose, can't wait till our first session.
Minutes later, we were still driving the boat towards the end of the reservoir. The size of the place was quite daunting. The next weekend, it was time for our first session. We arrived at around 5 o'clock after school had finished and had just enough time to set up and get the rods out. To our surprise, Carl hooked a fish that night, but it was so strong and snagged him around the buoy in the middle of the lake.
That was so good.
No.
Carp one, Carl and Alex. Nil.
However gutted we were, this session had shown us that we could get bites in this area, although it took a few more nights before we had our next bit of action.
Hello again, we're back at the reservoir and it's our third day and in fact our last day of our session. On the first evening we decided to set up right up by a nature reserve at the same place as we fished last time, and it's the shallowest water we can find. And although there's been so much rain and the water's actually come up like 3 or 4 foot since we were last here, it's still very warm. 19 degrees in the day, and that's extraordinary for this time of year. That night was completely uneventful. About 6-7 o'clock in the morning, I had a drop back bite, picked it up. I knew what it was, really. It was just a small bream. But it showed my rigs were working, and I'm sure if there were bream shells there, then carp would come in eventually. Throughout the middle day, I got a few more bites. They were only bream, but it still showed that the baits and rigs were working. But it was last night that I really want to talk to you about. Something really special happened, so check this out. It's the middle of the night and I've hooked my first carp from the reservoir.
Yeah, go for it, literally just go for it. Nope.
Can't believe how hard it's fighting. Just a minute ago, it was right at the right of the swim, trying to get into the bushes. And now it's coming right over to the left.
Go for it, Alex.
Finally. A result from the reservoir. I don't think I've ever been so happy in my life. Yes! So my first reservoir carp was in the net. I was so pleased, and from this huge expanse of water, I was so, so happy. Anyway, it's in the sling, so let's have a look at it.
Go
what I've just spotted. That is definitely the bait that we're using, Tangerine Dream. You can definitely tell it's just orange stuff coming out its other side. Now it's a very good sign, shows it's definitely been worth feeding, because he's obviously been eating it, and hopefully along with some others as well. Well, there's my prize. It's only a mid double, but it's probably the most happy I've ever been with a fish of this size. I've realized now all the work we've put in, all the baiting up, the hard work trying to cast far enough, all that boilie sticking, has been so worthwhile. And it's almost made it so much better catching one now. And it really doesn't matter how big they are.
Yes, Alex! Well done. After the capture of Alex's common, we became busy fishing and filming elsewhere, and throughout the winter months, the reservoir retreated to the back of our minds.
At the moment, we're in the middle of a cold, wet, damp, dark winter, and quite frankly, I'm fed up of it. And all I really want to do right now is go back to the reservoir. Due to the reservoir's immense size and depth, winter carp fishing would have been nigh on impossible, so we kept ourselves busy fishing shallower, more productive venues. So to keep me occupied on these long cold nights, I've decided to try and do a bit of research. I've been looking online, talking to some of the people who fish it, but to be honest, I can't really find much out. The people who are fishing it don't talk much of it, and on the internet there's nothing really. But what I have got is this. I've got a map of the land before the reservoir was there, and then the reservoir has been put on top of that map. So I can see where the old stream used to flow down. I can see where there could be sunken forests, because the forest was there before the reservoir was. And all these fields, which are all sunken when the reservoir filled up. The map has also enabled us to sort of work out roughly the depths. Obviously on here is the stream bed marked on, so that's going to be the deepest part of the valley. I've also been using Google Maps, mainly to try and actually work out how to access the swims. A lot of places there's just forest behind, you can't really push a barrow through there, so we're gonna have to get the boat across, and some places just are inaccessible completely. I've also been popping down the reservoir, just trying to keep our eyes on the water, going for walks, trying to find loads more spots, and we've actually found loads, and I'm really excited to fish them come spring. Anyway, we'll see you soon.
As spring approached and the temperatures rose, we began preparing our kit and tying rigs, ready for our spring campaign.
So here we are, Carl and I are back at the reservoir, and I'm really excited to be here. We've actually done 3 nights in the last week, and we haven't even caught a bream. A little bit disappointed, but to be honest, we knew it was going to be difficult. We're in a swim that we call the double, and we've been fishing around 80 to 100 yards out in water which must be about 10 to 15 foot deep. So pretty deep, especially as the water level is at its highest. What we've been doing is we've just been putting a scattering of boilies over the top of all our rods in hope that if the carp or the shoulder carp come over the top, they will notice the bait on the bottom and go down for a feed. But both Carl and I are really hoping that a carp shows up sometime soon.
To improve our chances, we decided to start pre-baiting with large quantities of particle. We decided to bait up the same swim as we fished previously due to its proximity to the shallow, weedy nature reserve. Once we arrived, we set to work trying to find a spot to pre-bait. With the use of our marker floats, we found an area of around 10 foot of water on a firm bottom leading down a slope to a silty gully. Because we believe the carps travel in large shoals, we baited a wide area, around half the size of a tennis court. This pre-baiting lasted a number of days on the lead up to our next session.
When we got round to actually fishing, we chose to bait up with the throwing stick to avoid driving the boat over our spot, potentially spooking the fish. Spring had finally arrived now, and once the rods were positioned perfectly, we felt more positive than ever before. Late that evening, we saw a fish roll, but we weren't sure whether it was a carp or perhaps a bream. The next morning, we awoke to a misty lake, but unfortunately for us, there was no action during the night.
I can't believe that. Had one of those typical morning bream bites, just a couple of bleats, bleep, bleep, bleep. I was thinking, not another bream. How annoying, you know. I thought that particle we pre-baited with has just brought in every bream in the lake. And then it starts like putting up a bit of a scrap, Alex.
Let the carp out.
No. I cannot believe that. And it's my first carp from the reservoir. It's about a bream sized.
Yeah.
Happy days. I'm freezing cold. That water's freezing out.
What a beautiful morning.
I caught the carp. So although it is absolutely tiny, and a carp of this size from anywhere else might not even warrant a photo, catching this has made me absolutely over the moon. Especially as we know this season we're sort of dedicated to fishing here at the reservoir. So we're going to send this one on its way, and hopefully, just hopefully, on our next session, we'll catch this one's grandma. It's a nice little carp.
Yeah.
So that was the end of our fourth night at the res, and we reluctantly packed up and went home. But it wasn't long before Carl started heading back during the week for some overnighters.
On many of these overnighters, I ended up casting out just on dark, but simply putting in the time helped me learn more and begin catching regularly. It was not all positive, however, as I somehow managed to lose a number of fish.
Eventually, after a couple of lost fish, it seems like I'm getting the better of them. I managed to have two last night. I'll quickly show you the first of them. What an absolutely stunning bronzy goldy coloured common. It's a good start. We're getting somewhere. We're making a bit of progress. I'll get a quick picture of this one and I better be back home, get some work done. The fishing up here at the reservoir is going well now, and I think as it gets warmer over the next couple of weeks, it'll only get better.
Following on from my week of overnighters, we decided a move was in order. We'd seen fish showing closer to the north bank, so up sticks and moved across. This new area also seemed to always hold a bit of colour. Whether it was due to underground springs, streams, boat traffic or carp, it was definitely worth exploring.
Location has got to be the most important thing with fishing, and especially somewhere this big. We could be almost 2 miles away from the fish. But last night we tried a new spot, got the rods out, and we were rewarded with 3 screaming runs. 2 of which I landed, the other one sadly came off, but we've got 2 beautiful commons to show you. The last week we've been doing short overnight sessions, getting here around 7 or 8 in the evening and then leaving at around 7 in the morning.
Yeah, perfect.
Once we got the boat over and got the rods out, we've been sitting back and watching the water. And normally in the evening, the reservoir goes flat calm and we can actually see right the way across. And if only carp do jump, we get to see them.
And then it was Carl's turn for some action, hooking a fish which pulled incredibly hard, forcing him to back one repeatedly.
Oh my god.
It's coming.
Yeah, but it's a big one.
Both Carl and I have got up early this morning as I've got schoolwork to do today and Carl's got some of his work. I'd normally be a bit gutted to have to go home and reel the rods in, but I'm not because the effort is finally paying off.
And there it is, the biggest and best reward that the reservoir's given us so far. We were catching numbers of small commons and we were thinking, if we keep catching them, surely something bigger and better is gonna show up. And as much as we enjoy catching those little commons, those beautiful little fish, something like this was really what we were after. Absolutely incredible. God knows how old it is, God knows if it's ever seen a hook before, but it's in perfect condition and it's the most incredible carp. Perfect
mouth.
Huge.
I can fit a golf, that's bigger than a golf.
It can fit a tennis ball in there. But looking out across all those acres of water, we know this is in here. Who knows what's in store for us next? Early this month we decided to move to the north bank rather than the south bank that we've been fishing up until then. The reason for doing so is because the sun would always be beaming down on this north bank, meaning it would be soaking up the sun, and hopefully we were thinking this margin would warm up quicker than the rest. We've actually had quite a few fish from this swim now. We've been doing a lot better than we were on the south bank. And I think the main reason for this is due to the fish shoaling up ready for spawning. What we noticed was, during the day, we might see the odd fish jump and crash right up in the nature reserve, but then come evening time, the shoal would move down, and if we were lucky, before midnight, so we'd get a take on our right-hand rod. If we were lucky enough to get another bite that night, it would normally come quite early morning, and what we believe to be is that is as the fish shoal is moving back up towards the nature reserve, as the majority of those morning bites would come on the further left-hand rod. So it would seem that moving to the north bank has been a very good idea, and we've definitely got in amongst that shoal on a number of occasions now, and from this spot which we're in now and the swim just a little bit further down to the left, we've actually had 7 fish now.
On one particular night, the shoal of carp really settled in our swim, producing 4 bites, of which we landed 3.
Other than that beautiful, immaculate 25 pounder that I've caught, the vast majority of the fish we've been catching have been quite small, sort of between 9 and 19 pounds. In fact, Alex, I think, has had 3 19 pounders now. So I'm really hopeful that he might catch a 20, but I think as the season progresses, we're gonna have to wade through as many of these small commons as possible, and who knows, we might come across a bigger one eventually.
About to get my last rod out, and we're fishing between 80 and 100 yards. This is a lot different to what we're used to. We used to fish in the very small waters between acre and 580s. This is 280. It's a huge expanse of water, and the fish could be a long way away. Because of this, we've had to up our equipment to tackle this huge water. Because of the strong tows, we've had to use bigger leads than we're used to. This one's a 3 ounce. In some even windier conditions, you might have to move up to a 4 or even 5 ounce. Strong lines as well, 13 foot rods. You might have seen us in our other videos using 9 footers. They're perfect for the small waters to medium waters, but when you come somewhere this big and you do need to cast in strong crosswinds at distance, then 13 foot rods, for me especially, I'm not exactly a good caster. They do help with the leverage. You can get it a bit easier. And to combine with that, I'm using a big pit reel. They also come in handy. The big spool just allows you to cast a lot further. But I'll just get this rod out, and then I'll be able to sit back and watch the water, and hopefully I might spot a carp. Whilst fishing here, we've had to overcome quite a few obstacles in terms of tactics. The first big problem that we saw straight away was the amount of bream in here. Bream are fun to catch up to a point, but when you're trying to catch that one special carp, they can get in the way. To overcome them, we basically just decided to step up our hook size and bait size. Rather than using our previously used size 10s and 8s, we're now using size 4s. I think we could even get away with a bit bigger because we're still getting a few bream. And then the baits, rather than using the 10 mils and 15 mils or the corn and the pepper army that we love using, we've had to use 20 mil bottom baits and 15 mil pop-ups. So quite a big hook bait there, but it certainly is still catching us some fish. The rigs have actually got simpler. As you can see here, I've just got a hair rig. That's as simple as it is, easy to tie, just go through the back, round, back through, and nothing on there, no shrink tubing, no nothing. We found this is all we need to catch carp. And often, the simpler the rig, the better. They're so easy to tie. If I have a spare half an hour at school and I want to get some rigs ready for the weekend, it will take me no time to tie 4 or 5 rigs, and I've got all my rigs ready for the weekend. Another reason for simplifying the rigs is that fish in here, they hardly ever get fished for. They won't be spooky of the rig, they won't be shy. And also, the simple rigs like this, they just work pretty much everywhere we go. Another major problem that we've had to overcome is the crayfish. There's absolutely thousands of them in here, but by shrimp racking the boilies like this, we've managed to solve that problem. And that seems to have solved the problem. We've caught a majority of the fish on that, so we're not worried that it affects the carp going down and picking it up. Although, on my last session, what I reeled in the morning was this. Even with the plastic on, shrunk around the bait, the crayfish have still got in there and tried to rip it to shreds. The main thing is though, I've actually still got a bait on. If I just had a normal bottom bait and pop up on there, I wouldn't have a bait on and I just would not get a bite. But with this, there's always still a chance for carp picking it up, and that's the main thing.
Now in terms of baiting, we've actually decided just to purely fish boilies now. Originally, the beginning of this season, we were baiting up quite heavily with particle and lots of maize as well. But we found it would just draw in far too many bream and indeed crayfish. You know, we were putting out baits reeling in half an hour later and the bream and crayfish had ruined them. So we decided to just go down the route of purely boilie fishing. Boilies we're using are 20mm TG Active, 20mm to try and avoid the bream once again, and also we find the 20mm in the boilie stick. We can pop them in there and absolutely get them going miles out. We're easily getting the boilies far enough on a calm day. However, if the wind is blowing an absolute hoolie down the lake, we have to use the spom instead. Now since we've started using the TG Active rather than the sort of more fruity flavour boilies that we were using before, we've actually caught a lot less bream. Now I don't know whether the bream prefer the fruity flavour or the carp just much prefer the sort of spicy boilies, but whatever it is, it seems to be doing the trick. Now over a spot we're maybe putting out 3-4 handfuls, sort of like handfuls like that, see if we can get the carp to sort of settle in the swim. And yeah, hopefully the carp get on it.
It's evening time now and I'm very excited for what the night might bring. Most likely thing that will happen is we'll blank, the fish won't be on us. But we could be lucky, and if a shoal does come over us, we could catch a fish. And that's what makes the fishing so special here. You just never know what's gonna happen. So I'm gonna sit back, watch the water, have some dinner, and I'll be off to bed. And hopefully I'll be woken by a screaming bite alarm.
To our surprise, the shoal of carp had moved again and we ended up on a blank. The next day we were back, Carl dropping me off before heading back to work to return that evening.
Well, bites here normally come in the middle of the night or early morning, but this one
absolutely screened off, and the sun is a good way up in the sky. And this one feels a little bit bigger than my other one. Oh. I'm getting so scared now.
Yes, yes, yes. Keep it coming, keep it coming.
High five, brother. Yes. Big,
wow.
Is it your biggest fish from here?
It's my biggest fish from here. I said it when I caught the big common in the park lake. I said it when I caught that catfish a few years ago. And we said it when we had that sturgeon in Canada. This is the best fish I've ever caught. But from the piece of water that I caught it from, the size of it, and the looks of it, I'm pretty sure this has got to be the best fish I've ever caught. 30 pounds, I'm blown away by the size of it. I'm speechless, this is incredible.
Alex, when we came here on our first few sessions, did you ever expect to catch a 30 pounder?
No, never. Oh my God, it is huge. I'm blown away. And now I'm gonna have to put it back.
Let me catch a bigger one.
Yes. Yes.
Having now caught an immense 30-pound common, we were excited to see what else the reservoir had to offer, and it was just a few days later when we made a return to our swim on the North Bank.
Flipping waders.
We found ourselves catching regularly and really enjoying our summer at the res. Once again, having to update our catch logbook on almost every session. On my next overnighter, I found myself awoken by yet another take. However, this time, it was definitely not a small common.
Oh my God. Oh my God.
And there she is. Now when we joined here in the autumn, we put in a lot of bait, quite a lot of time and a lot of thought into our approach and our tactics. We were eventually paid off last autumn with Alex's immaculate common that he caught.
but it didn't feel like we'd sussed it. So we've decided this year to spend as much time as we possibly can here. We've done the last couple of weeks fishing every overnighter that we possibly can, coming down to bait up, coming down for short overnight sessions, and after Axe's 30 pound common and a few more small commons working our way through them, we've gone and caught one of the absolute whackers.
Yes, Carl, that is huge.
37 pounds and 8 ounces, my second biggest fish ever, and from a place like this, I know I keep saying it, but catching one out of the reservoir for me is worth so much. Anyway, my arms are aching, so I'm gonna get a couple of photos and put it back. Oh, wow. Oh. Alex.
It's you.
It's like the best day of my life ever. Oh my god, what is that? It's the best thing ever.